tumors and unusual carotid artery presentation conditions. Introduction: the carotid body is a specialized chemoreceptor. It's located within the semi-adventitial tissue of the carotid bifurcation. It is stimulated by hypoxia, hypercapnia, and acidosis, and it controls the response with changes in blood pressure, heart rate, and respiratory rate by the release of catecholamines. CVTs are rather rare neoplasms, although they represent about 65% of head and neck parageliomas. History: in 1743, one Haller was the first to notice the carotid body. He did not call it that at that point of time. In 1862, Lushka carried out the first histological description of such neoplasia and named it carotid gland. In 1880, Reiner was the first dead to do the first surgery on the tumors in carotid space, and he resected the tumor along with the internal and external carotid arteries, but unfortunately, patient did not make it. 1886, Mädel successfully removed a glomus tumor from the carotid body, but the patient was aphasic and hemiplegic due to cranial nerve injury. 1894, Kopstein described the first case of CVT with lymph node. 1903, Scudder in the US was the first to remove the tumors and preserve the internal and external carotid arteries. 1913, Sapegno published the first account of distant Mets. 1940, Gordon Taylor described what we use today as the subadventitial dissection plan, which he named as the white line. 1988, Hallett et al. Had the largest study to date in a 50-year-old study with 153 cases and the trends that explained neurovascular complications of surgical management of carotid body tumors. 20th century, even till today, patients, doctors worldwide are recommending against resection of the tumor due to the risks involved, especially considering a Shamlin type 3. Epidemiology: prevalence of 1 to 2 per 100,000 population. According to Prachi et al., there is a 1.1 is to 1 lakh 1,000. 1 million incidence of carotid body tumors. They constitute of 65% of the head and neck parageliomas. Interestingly, the male to female ratio differs in patients dwelling at high altitudes. This is the ones which have chronic hypoxia, and that there is more female predominance when compared to males. Bilateral in about 5% of cases, and they may reach 32% if it has familial origin or is it genetically inherited. It's a disease of middle age with the mean age of onset at 45 years. But in cases where it is inherited, it is typically younger than the usual mean age. Parageliomas are inherited in 10 to 50% of cases. Relevant anatomy. There are small reddish brown oval structure located in the posterior medial aspect of the carotid artery bifurcation. Healthy gland measures 3 to 5 mm in diameter and weighs less than 15 milligram on average. Location: there are more tumors are present on the right side compared to the left side. We still don't know the reason for that. Majority of the literature states that it is located in the adventitia near the carotid artery bifurcation, but a study by Maxwell et al. Found that most surgeons who have experience with dealing with the carotid body tumors found that it is a little bit more peripherally located within the peri-adventitial tissue. This is important because adventitial dissection is more prone for injury to the vessel. A highly vascular supply, it's supplied through the Meyer's ligaments, primarily from the external carotid artery, external carotid artery from the ascending pharyngeal artery. Nerve supply, it's innervated by the herring nerve, branch of glossopharyngeal nerve, about 1.5 centimeter distal to the jugular foramen. Morphology, reddish brown, rubbery, and well circumscribed with the pseudocapsule. Microscopically also, it resembles normal carotid body architecture with a well-differentiated, usually benign appearance. Malignancy or benign nature cannot be made on based on histological findings, and it's only based on clinical behavior and on table findings. Metastatic disease, when present, usually spreads into the regional lymph nodes, that is the jugular groove. Zhang and colleagues propose that if there is a diagnosis of malignancy made from histology, it should have numerous giant cells, polymorphic, and or exhibit infiltration that is beyond the capsule. Histology. FNAC is not indicated. Only if the diagnosis is unclear via imaging studies, then FNAC may be done. On FNAC, it shows two cell types that are arranged in pseudo-alveolar pattern, characteristic of paragangliomas. These are known as cell ball, Zellballen in Germany. Type 1 cells, which are the chief cells, they predominate the keratin body tumor and contain catecholamine-bound granules. Type 2 are sustentacular cells, and they are located on the periphery, devoid of granules, and they're not functional. The only known risk factors are presence of chronic hypoxic stimulation and genetic predisposition. Pathophysiology, it's either sporadic type, familial type, or hyperplastic type. The familial form is a genetically heterogeneous entity. There are genes that are detected in succinate dehydrogenase coding, and the mutations in subunits D, C, and B are associated with the paraganglioma syndrome 1, 3, and 4. Genes in 2 have yet to be identified. Also, there are associations with the multiple endocrine neoplasias, von Hippel-Lindau and von Recklinghausen diseases. In people living at high altitudes and chronic COPD and cyanotic heart problems, the mechanism pathophysiology is hypertrophy, hyperplasia, and eventually neoplasia of the chief cells. The clinical presentation, it's the most common slow-growing asymptomatic neck mass located below the angle of the mandible. Most commonly presents as a slow-growing asymptomatic neck mass, Janssen et al. Did a study to find out the doubling time in the growth of the CBT, and they found that it was 7.13 years. And median growth rate was approximately 0.83 mm per year. Usually, if the size-related effects on the patient would be fullness, pain, dysphagia, odynophagia, hoarseness, and stridor. Functional CBTs, which are uncommon, but may present with due to neuroendocrine secretions, they may present with palpitations, headaches, hypertension, tachycardia, or flushing. On physical examination, it is vertically fixed and slight movement in the transverse direction. This is called the Fontaine sign. Other two signs associated sometimes with it is the Cocker's 1 and Cocker's 2, which is a heart tumor at palpation, which is between internal and external carotids, and tumor or heart swelling located in the tonsil region. It may or may not have a bruit. 10%, approximately 10% of the cases present with cranial nerve palsy, and the associated symptoms are pain, hoarseness, dysphagia, Horner syndrome, or shoulder drop. For workup, laboratory studies, hemoglobin may be done to see in patients with chronic hypoxia end up having slightly raised hemoglobin. That is just for giving more diagnostic assurance. Urinary catecholamines in patients who have any symptoms of a functional carotid body tumor. Genetic testing is suggested in susceptible families, and that has allowed for earlier detection of multicentric tumors and better prognosis in many patients. Differential diagnosis of swellings in the same region are carotid artery aneurysm or pseudoaneurysm, glomus vagal tumor, vagal schwannoma, carotid body hyperplasia, which is on the same spectrum of CBT, and a hematoma. Other than that, other swellings are a lymph node enlargement, branchial cyst, parotid gland tumor, or thyroid tumor. Imaging studies, a simple ultrasonography with color Doppler could be the first investigation, as it is non-invasive, and with some degree you can predict that it is a CBT. But CTA, head and neck, is more diagnostic, and it shows a hypervascular tumor located between the internal and external carotid arteries. MRA is a criterion standard. It shows a characteristic salt and pepper appearance on T1 image. On conventional angiography, we can view the Leiry sign, which is the splaying of the internal and external carotid artery. Conventional angiography also gives better visualization of the feeder vessels if an embolization is planned, and at the same time may also chance for a preoperative balloon occlusion test. If MRI is incompatible, functional tumors, if MRI is incompatible, a patient has claustrophobia or implants, then for functional tumors, MIBG scan may be done, and non-functional tumors, pentatriotide scan may be done. These are the features on different imaging studies. On ultrasound, it's a well-defined hypoechoic mass that displays the carotid bifurcation, hypervascular with low resistance flow pattern. In CT, it is a heterogeneously enhancing mass at carotid bifurcation with early arterial phase, strong and rapid enhancement. In MRI, it is nearly similar to muscle on T1 and hyperintense on T2, and it shows a classic salt and pepper appearance on T1. Splaying of the carotids is seen in DSA, and it also shows the blood supply and can help in planning for surgery. So Doppler images showing the mass between the ECA and ICA with the mixed echoes within. This is a carotid angiogram showing the mass between the ICA and ECA. This is a bilateral tumor in a patient, familial origin. It's again a mass with 3D reconstruction color coding showing this tumor nestled between the ICAEC. This is a maximum intensity projection done on a PET scan showing hypermetabolic lesions in the neck and in the mediastinum. This is suggestive of bilateral CBT with metastasis. So Shamblin staging. Stage 1 tumors are typically placed between the internal carotid and external carotid and do not involve any of the major nerves, or only partially involve the vessel wall. Type 2 almost nearly totally engulf the vessels and might even involve the nerves. Type 3 is when all the vessels are completely encircled. So types 2 and 3 are more likely to require carotid resection. And the reason for staging is to prognosticate surgical time and perioperative bleeding and resectability of the tumors and the risk associated with it. Luna et al. Made a modification to Shamblin's staging, and he found that if the tumor is intimately adherent, wherein there is areas of visible tumor encroaching upon the vessel wall or even involving it, then it is described as class 3B irrespective of its size. And the class 3A is represented by the original class 3 as described by Shamblin. Arya et al. Also made a modification that says the angle of contact from the center of ICA to the tumoral edge is also an assessment of vascular encasement. And he divided into degrees of encasement, less than or equal to 180 degree, greater than 180, less than 270, and greater than or equal to 270. Strogan et al. Also, most recently, 2015, did a study that showed that the distance from the base of skull is more predictive for cranial nerve lesion and the amount of perioperative blood loss. Use the C2 dense as the reference point, and anything more than 3 centimeters from the C2 dense is associated with more blood loss. And this was predictive of cranial nerve lesion injury as well as blood loss, while as tumor volume is only related with blood loss alone. the same Luna et al.'s modification. Treatment options: surgery as soon as the diagnosis is made has been the standard. One study, small study, was done that said observation could be given as an option for small CBTs for people in chronic hypoxic conditions above altitude of 2000 meters above sea level, and if the tumors are hyperplastic and less than 2 centimeter. Otherwise, all tumors have to be operated, the earlier the better. Operative risk is directly related to the size and extent of the tumor. Patients with poor medical condition, elderly patients, or patients with recurrent tumors are usually treated with radiotherapy. The goal of radiotherapy is to slow or halt the progression, but not as a curative treatment. Bilateral carotid body tumors, staged excision may be planned because concurrent removal of both the tumors leads to labile blood pressure and due to bilateral herring nerve excisions. So pre-procedure counseling, it's important to tell the patient and family members about the risks of cranial nerve injuries that may occur, and even the possibility of a bypass or a vein graft or reconstruction that is required, and the risk of stroke and death. There should be a discussion between surgeon and anesthetist regarding whether you want paralysis to aid in muscle retraction and to facilitate the use of electrocautery, or not to be paralyzed, so it will aid in the identification of cranial nerves with the stimulator. Pre-op planning, vein mapping of the greater saphenous vein may be beneficial for large CBTs when reconstruction is expected. Cerebral monitoring and protection should also be planned and coordinated with the concerned staff neurologist. EEG monitoring plus or minus shunting of the internal carotid artery discussed. Pre-op embolization. In Shamblin group 2 and 3, it's still controversial, but in group 2 and 3 tumors, some authors suggested embolization. Angiography is performed. The procedure is angiography is performed with selective catheterization of the EC and embolization of branch vessels feeding the tumor. The pros of this is reduction in blood loss, surgical time, length of stay, and perioperative complications, according to the study. The cons, though, are risk of inadvertent cerebral embolization and stroke, and additional invasive procedure with, again, patient discomfort and increase the overall cost of care. This is a picture showing, this picture shows the embolized feeder vessel, where there's no visualization of the tumor. This is the same pre-procedure, procedure, and post-procedure embolization. In surgery, the position is a low Fowler's position with the head end raised 15 to 30 degrees. Incision should be centered over the carotid bifurcation. Ligation of the facial vein is done, which facilitates lateral retraction of the IJV and access to the common carotid. Techniques for extended exposure include incision across the mastoid process behind the ear, detachment of the posterior belly of the digastric muscle from the mastoid process for high tumors, division of the styloid muscle, styloid process also may be required, or subluxation or division of the mandible entirely to remove large tumors. Technique, there are a few, only few described variations. So the standard caudocranial technique is wherein the bifurcation, aortic bifurcation tumor part is dealt with first, and it is eventually peeled off up to the top while protecting the nerves. But Van der Vogt and Hemming et al. Proposed the cranial to caudal dissection technique. In this, it permits early identification of vital neurovascular structures and reduced intra-op time and bleeding. Again, there's not much difference. This technique simplifies the more tedious dissection on the ventral surface of the tumor. Shunting, EEG monitoring shows ischemic changes with clamping of, or he fails a balloon occlusion test, then a distal shunt is shunting should be done. Distal shunt is passed into the ICN held in place by gentle inflation of the distal balloon. Proximal shunt is passed retrograde into the common carotid artery and can be held in place with a proximal balloon or a rumble tourniquet. They're showing the exposed tumor along just bifurcation. Common carotid artery, IJV, and vagus have been tagged. This is control of vascular structures and cranial nerves that have been identified. Dissection is done and partially peeled off from the ECA. Although this for this patient, the tumor was densely adherent to the ECA, and we had to sacrifice ligating the ACL lobe. So there is another technique, they say, called the retrocaroted dissection technique, in which we release the anterolateral lobe first and proceed with the posterior luxation of the mass. That means we transfer the mass behind the carotids and continue our dissection from there. This step enables better views of the adventitial plane, and careful dissection of most of the posterior lobe of the tumor can be done easily. It's supposed to reduce operative time loss and is more malignant cases where ECA is bound to be sacrificed. This picture showing the same. In picture B, the mass is being freed off initially, and then in picture C, you can see the posterior luxation. And then reconstruction of the ECA was done with a saphenous vein graft. So post-excision field, preserving all the... Here you can see the hypoglossal and the vagus. So excised specimen. Patient is observed for any post-operative hemorrhage or late stroke. In patients who underwent vascular reconstruction, ICU admission is preferred with heparinization. A patient should be closely follow up for local recurrence. It can be done once in 6 months to a year. Contralateral tumors should also be resected after 3 months. Significant morbidity while removing the first tumor might lead person to consider radiation for the other side. Complications associated with the surgery. The most common injured nerve is the superior laryngeal nerve, and this nerve supplies cricothyroid and provides sensation. So some degree of aspiration and voice changes, that is inability to shout in loud crowds, will be present for SLN injury. Vagus nerve injury results in vocal cord paralysis with resultant hoarseness and increased aspiration risk. But usually high vagal injuries in large tumors. So it also involves the superior nerve, and the combined causes a significant problem of aspiration because of throat as well as paralyzing it. It may be compensated record over time. Otherwise, vocal cord medialization should be procedure should be performed by the ENT surgeon. Hypoglossal nerve injury, speech, it leads to speech and swallowing problems. If on table, primary reanastomosis could be done, it should be attempted. If it fails, then other options include a greater auricular nerve graft. Axillary nerve injury leads to post-op shoulder pain and weakness. It sometimes very debilitating shoulder pain and weakness. There is something called first bite syndrome, which is a complication that occurs when sympathetic supply to the parotid gland is severed. This basically clinically, it is when a patient starts his meal in the first bite, they tend to have a lot of severe pain on that side of the parotid. And there is no treatment for that. And this so far, Botox has been tried to some people who have really bad symptoms, but no such permanent treatment exists. In case of bilateral condition with loss of bilateral herring nerves, patients experience elevated blood pressures, and these are difficult to control medically. Hence, staging is better than bilateral tumor excisions, because it gives time for the compensation provided by the aortic baroreceptors. Conclusion, even though it was said as early as 1917, these curious little tumors have been dissected, studied, described almost ad nauseum et ad infinitum, but there is still a lot to be learned. The B, sir.